Good evening, everybody. I'd like to open up the Carver Redevelopment Authority meeting for Monday, December 19th, 2016. First thing, if anybody wants copies of any of the paperwork, it's up here on the desk. And there's a sign-in sheet also. First on our agenda, we're going to future discussion on the urban renewal plan, 127 acres of the property owned for Route 44 development located off of Montello Street in North Carver. Marlene, I'm looking for an update on what has transpired since our last meeting.
Sure. So, unfortunately, my laptop is in the shop, so we're going to have to do this kind of the old-fashioned way. Okay. I printed off a PowerPoint deck for everyone. Mm-hmm. It looks like this. And I'm going to go, I can't project it up on the screen for you, but hopefully we'll be able to follow along on the paper. Mm-hmm. So you do all have a version of the plan and the appendices that looks like this.
Oh, yeah.
And that was what was emailed out on Friday. So couple of things I want to bring your attention to on page one of your PowerPoint deck, okay? So map B, the spot clearance map has been changed so that you can see the in this rectangular lot here, the Tusher's property has been revised to be shown as an existing structure to remain. Based on your discussion from the last meeting. The next page is map C, and these are the existing parcel boundaries. And I just wanna, I know we've talked about this, but I just wanna make sure that everybody's doubly clear that the parcel boundaries that we're using in these figures are, they're approximate and they're based on the public records that we have. None of these maps are engineered plans. None of them are stamped by a professional land surveyor. And we are making no claim that these are surveyed boundaries. On your next page, table 8, this is from page 57 in your draft plan, and you'll see that it includes a budget line for acquisition surveys and title searches. So you can see the urban renewal costs, you can see the subtotal for real estate costs, and then the land acquisition expenses. So before any property is acquired by you, a survey and a title search would be part of the work that would have to be done before any property is transferred, and a survey and the title search would document for you where exactly these property boundaries are. So just so we all understand that the figures in the plan are based on parcel data that is good, but it's not as exact as an instrument survey. But before anything is transferred, a survey will be done. The next slide is map G, and there's two changes here. Again, the rectangle here, the Tusher property, has been changed from a full acquisition to a partial acquisition. And on the other side of Montello Street, the northern Webby property has also been added to your partial acquisition list. So this is the change in the map. And then on the next page of your deck is the change in the matrix that's in your plan. And this is from table 2 on page 25 of your plan. And now you're seeing those three partial acquisitions on lines 12, 23, and 24. So those are the changes on that piece of it. Map H is the disposition parcel, and that is, that has also been amended to reflect the map G change. So the acquisition parcel is the large gray parcel. That's the disposition parcel. So that's the parcel that all the land will be acquired and combined to be disposed. So that's the disposition parcel. And then the three pieces in the dark gray are the parcels that the plan has outlined as partial acquisitions on the previous table for roadway realignment purposes only. So if you go back a page in the deck to the table, near the second column from the right on the partial only acquisition line, so on line 12, 23, and 24, those are the partial acquisition for roadway realignment only. So that's the table version, and then map H and map G are the plan versions of that information.
Understood.
Okay. So map I was revised to show the location of a potential warehouse site to avoid the Tusher's property. So map I is your conceptual development plan, and the warehouse was shifted into the site. So that is a change on this plan. I do want to draw your attention though to the next slide, paragraph, and this is from page 67 on your plan, and I especially want to draw your attention to the first paragraph, and I'm going to read that for you. It says, the improvements illustrated in Figure I, Conceptual Site Development Plan, and land uses are conceptual in nature and are intended to depict one manner in which the project area could be developed consistent with the North Carver URP. Proposed redevelopers of the subject sites will be provided with the opportunity to propose an alternative land use and/or building configuration subject to the requirements of the North Carver URP, the objectives of the Town of Carver and the CRA, and the applicable law. All development proposals must be reviewed and approved by the CRA and the appropriate public bodies of the Town of Carver. So what we're saying in that paragraph, and what I want to reiterate, is that Map I is one potential concept. It's not a promise that this is how it's going to end up looking on the ground.
Right.
This is a conceptual plan that shows how something might happen. The square footages are, you know, essentially up to 1.85 million square feet that have been analyzed and looked at. It may be that's kind of the maximum, the limit. It may end up being much less. The buildings might be in a completely different configuration, but this is showing one use of the property. So I want you to be, you know, I want to be especially clear on that.
Okay.
Two pieces of information that were outstanding in our previous conversations were the tables 5 and 6 on page 44 and 45 of your plan. Those have been finalized with the assumed multipliers for job creation and square footage costs. So if you look at these, table 5 has, you know, again, based on your conceptual plan, one possible scenario. So if you end up with, you can see the estimated square feet for office or light manufacturing, the cost per square foot that we're assuming for that construction, same for warehouse light manufacturing, same for warehouse. the projected construction values based on those square footages. Obviously, if those square footages are lower, then, you know, the numbers are adjusted accordingly. The dollars per square foot are assumptions. They're based on kind of standard multipliers. So they may, you know, there may be actual variance in there when the time comes to actual construction. But these are, at this point, we don't have a project with construction documents to put out to bid, so we have to do our best to estimate the costs. So these are the numbers that we're using for costs. And then likewise, table 6, it's the same type of exercise. Again, we're assuming these types of land uses based on industry multipliers of how many jobs per square foot, which, you know, is just an assumption, gives us, you know, we're assuming so many square feet of new construction, and then that gives us the projected jobs. Again, based on the actual square footages, the actual land uses, and the actual employment numbers, subject to change. But these are the estimates that are kind of, you know, a standard idea of what you're looking at for this type of project. The next slide shows the schedule of public actions, and this is from page 59 of the plan. The Board of Selectmen has set their hearing date for January 5th. That's a Thursday. In the plan, it's in the past tense, but I mean, right now, it hasn't happened yet, obviously. The board, we have decided to notice the Board of Selectmen hearing in accordance with Chapter 40A and 41. That's not required, but it's the most strict standard of notice. So the Urban Renewal Plan is developed under Chapter 121B, and it actually doesn't specify advertising in the newspaper or mailing notices to abutters or anything. And there's a lot of permit work that would have to happen for a project like this. Wetlands permits, Board of Health permits, Planning Board permits, subdivision plan. So, and depending on what statute you're working under, you have different notice requirements. So, 121B, this plan's statute is silent. And the Board of Health doesn't require advertising in the newspaper, but does require notice to direct abutters. The Conservation Commission requires notice to direct abutters and one ad in the newspaper 10 days before the hearing. The Planning Board for a special permit under 40A and the Planning Board for a definitive plan under Chapter 41 requires two ads in the newspaper no less than 14 days before the hearing, as well as certified mail to abutters and two abutters within 300 feet. So that's the most strict standard. And because there's already one Planning Board special permit issued for this property, and there's going to be probably at least one more Planning Board special permit, as well as a future definitive plan, I wanted to use the Planning Board procedures to kind of limit confusion as to why notice might be different from case to case. So we're noticing the Board of Selectmen's hearing at the same in the same way, using the same procedures as the Planning Board. So an ad was in last Friday's paper. The second ad will be in this week's paper, the Carver Reporter, and certified mail will go out to the abutters in Carver, Plimpton, and Middleborough probably both in tomorrow's mail and Wednesday's mail. We'll get them done probably by Wednesday. So that's the public hearing, and we've taken kind of a very strict stance on notice for that.
And that's for the selectmen's?
Yes, the selectmen is the body that has to hold the public hearing on the plan. The planning board has to take a vote to make two findings with regard to this plan. And I've talked to the planning board at its last two meetings about that. If you're ready, the earliest they could vote would be at their next meeting, which is the 27th. And the two findings that they have to make are, one, they have to find that your urban renewal plan is consistent with the master plan for the community. And in your document, we go through all of the planning history that's happened on this site, including the master plan, the water district, the economic development planning. So that is well laid out for the planning board to take a look at and discuss. The second finding that the planning board has to make is that they have to find that the plan is based on a local survey, and they're not. And the language in the urban renewal plan regulations for surveys, they're not using the term survey like we used the term survey just a little bit ago with an instrument on the ground land survey. What they're looking for the planning board to do is they're looking for the planning board to look at the methodology of your plan and that it's based on, based on current data. So we're using the current tax rate, we're using the current assessor's data, we're using the current information we have, not out-of-date data. We have, Maureen Hayes, your consultant, and I have done a number of site visits to verify what is actually on the property, and that it does, the number of buildings match the number of buildings that we're showing on your plan and matches field cards and field records as well. So that methodology piece is what the planning board is looking at, as well as the compliance with the master plan. You obviously will have to take a vote to approve the plan, and once you do that, then it can be advanced to the planning board. And then the Board of Selectmen, after they close their public hearing, so they'll open it on the 5th. Obviously, they have every right to continue it as many times as they want to hear the information. They have time to close their public hearing. They have time to discuss it and deliberate, and then at some point they have to take a vote. And so, once they've taken a vote, that'll be the final public, approval that's necessary. On the next slide, we talk about Massachusetts and Environmental Policy Act, and this is MEPA. So MEPA doesn't issue a permit per se, but they do a review. And in order to submit an urban renewal plan to DHCD, you also concurrently have to file with MEPA, and they have to review the project for any environmental impacts, and they would suggest, and they would require any mitigation to those impacts. Now, you and I will be working on an environmental notification form for the plan that will get sent up to MEPA. Once you have voted that the plan is the way you want it and it says what you want it to say, then that information in the plan gets put into your MEPA filing. So once you vote your plan, then I can move forward with starting that for you. MEPA can be a little confusing because we are applying for the plan, and the MEPA review for the plan will cover table 1 on page 6, which I don't think I have in here. I don't. So table 1 on page 6 are your proposed urban renewal actions, and it includes acquisition, relocation, clearance, zoning, and infrastructure. So what it does not include are any individual building projects that come later. So the plan review part of it will be under one MEPA review, and they'll look at the plan and they'll say, you know, if any of your roadway realignment causes alteration to wetlands, they'll tell you how you need to handle that. Now, they will reserve and they will review separately any impacts that are caused by any of your developments on your conceptual plan. So anytime any of one of those buildings come in, they have to go to MEPA on their own. They have to describe their traffic, greenhouse gas, any wetlands impacts they might have. They have to talk about how they're going to control stormwater. So all of the environmental concerns dealing with the individual buildings and its associated impacts, meaning traffic, noise, lighting, stormwater, MEPA will review those too separately when there's real information about that. So right now they're reviewing what the plan says, if there are any identifiable impacts to the environment that need to be mitigated from the plan, that's what they'll talk to you about. They'll talk directly to the project developer for any of the building and any of the mitigation for the building projects. So as we get into it, I'm hoping that it might make more sense, but it is a confusing process. So as we go through the whole MEPA part, don't hesitate to ask me questions. I don't know if I'll be able to answer them, but I'll be able to find out the answers for you. The opinion, so town council has to write an opinion that 121, or that your plan is in compliance with 121B. They haven't yet done that, but it is underway. So it's something that if they find that there's a part of the plan that doesn't comply, we have to go back and fix it. So as they do their analysis, we'll talk about it and you'll see it. But essentially, it's not something that's going to be open for you to change. You're going to get it. And we'll have to, it'll either say, yes, this is fine, or it's going to say, no, you need to go do X, Y, and Z. So it's not really open for debate. So on page 64 of your draft, it talks about the relocation due to your urban renewal plan, and table 9 has been revised in your slide deck you have table 9 from that page, and it's been revised to remove the Tusher property. And then section 12, which is citizen participation, and it's on page 68, and it's also in your slide deck. This is something that we're not done yet with citizen participation, so this will continue to be updated even after it's advanced to the planning board and advanced to the board of selectmen. So this is something that until everything is all done, this will continue to reflect the changes. Now, in the appendices, the FXM report is appendix number one, and we received that in June, and it hasn't changed since then. So that's, you know, kind of been set for a while. Appendix number two is an engineering report, and I just put an example of table number two in the deck. It's a couple of pages long, and what the engineering report does is it describes the assumption behind the budget estimates. So it's pretty much a broad overview of the major components for the site work and infrastructure. It's not for the buildings. It's for preparing the site to be built upon. And again, just like all the other budget assumptions, the costs will be refined as designs for individual projects are advanced. So in the example I gave you in the slide deck on table two, you know, you can see what our estimates are. We're estimating so many linear feet of water main, the cost of that, and you know, that gives you kind of the rough estimate for water main. However, if you know the site road is shorter or longer, this will need to change accordingly. If it's shorter, there'll be less main and fewer hydrants. If it's longer, there'll be more main and more hydrants. So this is just an example of right now kind of a very rough estimate of what we're looking at for these costs. And that's all included in Appendix 2. Appendix 2 also includes a very general schedule of tasks. So that's Table 3 in your deck. It's anticipated schedule for activities, and they're really at this point only organized by year. And it's pretty much just showing the general order in which things will go. Obviously, all of this is dependent on the permitting process and on the market's ability to fund all of this. So if the permitting takes longer and the funding is slow, then it'll take longer. So again, it's just our best estimate now. Appendix number three is outstanding. Appendix number three follows the process described on 59, which is this page again. It's the public approval process. So appendix number three will be populated as these dates happen and as these votes are taken. Appendix number four is your preliminary relocation plan. It's the last slide in the deck, and it has also been updated to remove the Tusher household. Appendix number five is a copy of your preliminary developers agreement, which you guys signed way back at the beginning of this, and that identifies Route 44 development as the preferred redeveloper. It also identifies the redeveloper's responsibility to provide the necessary funding. And then the last part of your appendices, appendices six, is the citizen participation summary. This includes copies of minutes, agendas, correspondence that you've received. It will be updated, you know, as we go. It'll be added to, and I will provide just a summary sheet at the beginning, kind of outlining what's included, the dates of the meetings, and those items. So that's pretty much where we stand right now.
Okay. The ongoing meetings with the planning board, selectmen, those will also be added to this?
Yes.
Okay. Questions from the board? Joanna, you got anything?
My head's kind of swimming at this point.
Brian, you got anything?
My question's about it was one of the maps.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see if I can just find it, point to it. Maybe you could tell me. Let's see.
Yeah.
So let me see if I can.
Map H.
Map H.
Okay.
So, on the corner across from the Tusher property, there's a little, that bend in the road right there.
Yep.
There was an email that came to us this week, I believe it was this week, stating something about some of the property. There was like some kind of a misunderstanding in the lines of someone's property. I think it was, that the piece of property right there across the way?
No, that it's actually the an email from Mr. Butler. So it's at this northern, piece up here.
Oh, well, okay. Because it looked like that piece there. It just kind of like was reminiscent of it. So I wanted to make sure I was clear. So, okay. Does that have any effect on, it's out of our boundary line. So it really doesn't have any effect on any of what we're talking about tonight, correct?
It will. And that's why I brought up the fact that a survey has to be done. So right. That boundary will be determined as part of the survey and title research that will have to be done. And it bounds the Walsh property, which is the 30-acre piece where the old septic plant was.
Oh, okay.
So it will, it is a line that we do need to determine where it is before that property is transferred. But okay. The survey and the title research will do that.
Okay. That's the only question I had. Thanks.
Okay, I'm all set. Thank you for the update on that. Joanna, anything?
You just asked me that question.
Yeah, because I moved on. I knew that you were still just thumbing. I just want to make sure I worked with you.
Okay. So I want to talk a little bit about at our last meeting. We had talked about Mr. and Mrs. Tush's property. The developer had said that he had no problem with taking that out of the plan. As you noticed that in the documents that were provided to us tonight, the revisions, there's parcels in there of the Tusher's property that is to be acquired for roadway realignment only. What's the pleasure of the board on those statements?
Go ahead. Start with me.
Whoever wants to speak up.
I think there was an email that we got earlier from the Tusher people, Mr. and Mrs. Tusher. I feel that this should be removed, and we don't really need to take any roadway or any realignment. I think there's enough to figure out with these webby wetlands or whatever, and... So I feel that the board should make that correction and take that out.
Okay. Right? What are those thoughts that Joanna had on removing the Tushes from the partial acquisition of the roadway?
Well, as much as I'd like to say that I totally agree, I would like to see, we talked about language that could be put into beyond, you know, this. The statement that's in a block that could, you know, be made to secure the, you know, whatever was needed of that piece of property. So that way when we do our roadway and we do find out in the future that we need to inch it this way or inch it that way, we're not completely blocked from doing some roadway. I have no problem with taking the Tusher property off. But I just think that that's something that the board needs to think about before you say yes or no. That's my thoughts. I mean, if the majority of the board wants to take the Tusher property off, I have no problem doing that. But I just think that's something that needs to be brought up before we say yay or nay.
Your thoughts on that?
I go along with the same thing as Joanne just stated.
My thoughts on this is twofold. I do agree partially with what Brian's saying, that the conceptual idea of any type of roadway improvements having a have an effect on the Tessa property. Could possibly happen if there was any type of improvements going on up there. There is also the Webby property up there. What's wet, what isn't wet, you don't really know until any type of survey is done or any type of potential impacts of any type of development if it ever comes to fruition. I think me personally at this stage of the game, to put a partial acquisition on a piece of property that might be impacted maybe on some type of potential development, I'm struggling with. I've been struggling with that for a couple of weeks now. As we looked at this potential development in the urban renewal plan, we looked at, I'm just going to use it as a phrase, the coal access road, where the majority of the road traffic would take place. It is a public way. Montello Street now. I think to put this partial acquisition on just a small sliver, and we're talking about 0.97 on that parcel of the Tushes, I'm struggling with that. On some type of development that might happen.
Can I ask, is there an easement in the town that says, the first 6 feet of your property go to sidewalk anyway, or does that apply here?
No, so no. There's a layout,
mm-hmm.
and the property line is the layout line. So there's the paved surface of Montello, which is relatively narrow.
Yeah.
Then that paved surface is within a wider layout, and that looks like anyone's property, but it's not. It's in the layout. So there is space around the paved surface that is in the layout owned by the people of the town of Carver. That space in the layout can be used to widen or change any street. All streets have a layout.
Right.
Once you leave the layout, you're on private property. So the property line and the layout line are one and the same. On one side of the line, it's public. And it's the way. And on the other side of the line, it's private, and it's the front yard setback of the lot. If the layout is not, if there's just not enough space in the layout to accommodate whatever the design is, and the problem here is we don't have a survey, we don't have the exact information on the layout. We don't have the exact information on the location of things. We don't have a design, so we don't know what we need. So there's a lot of uncertainty. The layout is there. It can be used, and it won't affect, using the space in the layout will not affect the anyone's private lot.
Okay.
If you don't have enough space in the layout, let's say right there at that curve on Montello, you can decide tonight that you're either going to redesign your project somehow to make it work. It may not be optimal, but it'll still be adequate, or you're going to shift all of your improvements and all of your work to the east and use maybe more of the Webby property. So you have options here. You have, we don't know what we need. Mm-hmm. We don't know what exactly the final design is going to be, because until this plan moves forward, nobody's going to fund it. So if you want to say that 100% of the Tusher's lot is off limits, it's to remain whole, you can do that. Just understand that your design, whatever your design is, has to use the existing layout width and then property to the east. And you have to make it work doing that.
Which is all a conceptual. That's the problem that I'm having with, but it's all conceptual.
This, right.
Not everything. Having a survey that's showing me that the turn of radius of A, B, and C.
Right.
It's not helping me that much.
It's not, because we're very used to looking at definitive engineered plans that are very exact. I mean, they're, you know, precise. This is not that case. This is a 20-year, very conceptual master plan for a very large area. All of that engineering and all of that work is why your budget in Table 8 is so huge. That's because all of that, all of, you know, reducing and eliminating all of that uncertainty has to happen through all of this engineering work. Yep. So
that's my problem with that. I mean, it's hard to say whether or not, for me, not having that certainty. Mm-hmm. I think that on the Webby parcel, there's room to do that. If it's wet there, you can apply for permits.
Yep.
To, you know, replicate that and stuff. So I don't know. That's my thoughts on that.
Well, I mean, after listening to what I just listened to, it sounds to me like we have more options than the one option that everyone was stuck on for so long. So I think I'd have to say that if we scratch the Tusher property off of this map, it would probably not affect us in too great of a, you know. So it wouldn't be too, we wouldn't miss it, I don't think.
You good with that? Agree with it. So I'd like to make a formal vote of that. Does somebody want to make a vote to remove the...
I'll do that right now.
Tusher's property.
All right. So I'd like to make a motion that we remove the Tusher property from the map and from the urban renewal.
From partially to be acquired to...
Yeah, from partially to be acquired to be to not be acquired.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to remove the Bruce and Karen Tusher's property from partially acquired to not to be acquired from the urban renewal plan. Any other discussion? No. Seeing and hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Okay.
So, Mr. Chairman, I just have another question. When we first started with the planning board, talked about master plan. How is that has to sync up because we're still working on the master plan?
So, yeah, so the planning board actually had a very good discussion about that. And if you can look in your, just give me 1 minute here. So if you can look in your draft plan on page 27, because the planning board is concerned, and I think rightfully so, they're concerned about kind of this, the master plan is also being updated.
Right.
While you're doing this urban renewal process, and they're a little bit out of sync, and the master plan is lagging behind and won't go to town meeting until April. Right. And on page 27, the second bullet point, Town Master Plan 2001. The 2001 plan is the one that is in effect. And however, the last sentence of this paragraph, it says the town's master plan is currently being updated with the Southeast Regional Planning and Economic Development District, SERPED. And it is clear that the subject area will continue to be designated a priority for economic development. And from the master planning process, this area of town is talked about in land use, it's talked about in economic development. So it was a priority in 2001 and it will continue to be a priority in the in the updated version.
Okay. So I guess the question I had was syncing up on this one here.
Mm-hmm.
you mentioned the town, the master plan, I guess, in here.
Yeah, so the planning, that's one of the findings the planning board has to make. So the planning board has to find that your urban renewal plan is consistent with the town's master plan priorities.
I guess my question is, even though it says it in this plan of 2001, is the planning board going to say, can we have the master plan, the new master plan? Are they going to hold up that time frame because they want to see the new master plan?
I think the planning board understands that it's in the old one and it's coming in the new one. I can't speak for them. They haven't voted yet, but I have had the discussion with them. We've discussed it, you know, kind of in depth about the fact that, and they do have the new version of the master plan.
Okay.
So they have seen that this is an area of town that has continued to be, you know, talked about for economic development.
Okay.
So,
I just kind of wondered what they were going to do. Kind of answers the plan.
Yeah. Okay. Other questions from board members? Any other questions from you guys?
No, not that.
Okay.
That's yours.
Yeah, that's my stuff.
Before we move on with this, I'd like to entertain anybody from the public, if you have anything that you'd like to say on any of the new information that has been brought forward tonight, if you please come up, identify yourself, and let us know. I'm looking for any type of concerns you had with tonight's information. Mr. Tusher.
I just have a couple of things. I want to thank you very much for your vote. I appreciate that, first and foremost. And I don't know what, as far as the zoning of our property will be, will that change? Is that subject to change? Do you have any ideas on that?
So right now the property is zoned Green Business Park. That is the current zoning.
Yeah.
The planning board has made a motion to take the two properties that are split by the town boundary, Mr. Massingham's property and Mr. Jackson and Ms. Singletary's property.
Mm-hmm.
They will be taken to town meeting for rezoning. Would you like to have your property rezoned to residential agricultural? Or do you want to think about that and let me know?
I do want to think about it, yeah, because I don't know what would be, if I ever, you know, in the future, you know, if I live long enough to make a change or something, would I want to have the zoning? I'd have to change the zoning from residential to back to things, so.
Right, so right now your zoning won't change and your zoning's not scheduled to change.
Yep.
Unless I hear differently from you.
Okay. That's good. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I'm Gordon Massingham. I live on Montello Street. Resident of Plimpton, but I'm a Carver taxpayer, and my property abuts the property that will be possibly developed as part of this plan. And first of all, I want to thank the board for removing the Tusher's property altogether. I think that was a major sticking point for a lot of people in the town. I think things may go a lot better since that's happened. I also congratulate you for putting some facts and figures to this. The cost for it, there's a lot of issues in the cost, but something north of $32 million is going to be the cost of this. And it's planned that it would create 1,500 permanent jobs, and that it will create $5 million in taxes to the town. Well, this doesn't take into consideration that the property already does give some taxes to the town, not $5 million, I would estimate maybe $300,000 or $400,000. So that's all not totally profit there. In the plan on page 8, you talk about citizen participation, and I noticed that in the added parts, you put a lot of the minutes and comments that people made, but nowhere did I see it reflected that in terms of citizen participation, they have been almost overwhelmingly opposed to this project. And we've asked for a show of hands. I'm going to do it again tonight. And inevitably, everyone is against the project. But you never mention that. The only two comments I see from citizens who are in favor of the product, a project, are people who sold their property to the developer. And they got their money, they're getting out of town, and sure, they put a little note that they're in favor of the project, but they're not going to be here to have to live with it. That was on page 8, and I think there should be some identification of that. Page 23 in the plan, I noticed it was a map that proposes a giant electrical substation adjacent to a residence. That's Mr. Butler's residence. And I think that I don't see the electric company going for that. And I think you need to rethink that idea. On page 31, the subject of tax incentives is mentioned. That the town master plan encouraged the use of tax incentives to develop for development. And I want to ask the question, have any tax incentives been offered to the Route 44 Development Corporation?
No.
On page 32, it's mentioned that there's already a plan to use some of the tax money that comes from the finished plant to take care of the debt of the North Carver Water District. So you can see we're already earmarking where that money is going to go. Now, this adds to another issue regarding the North Carver Water District, which I've addressed before and I have to address again, especially since recently I attended a meeting of the North Carver Water District. And even though no one was allowed to comment before the meeting, I did buttonhole the chairman of the the commission, and asked them a few questions, particularly as it relates to this urban development plan. And he told me that he knew nothing of the plan, that it wasn't even on his radar, he said. Yet, I also noticed from listening to the meeting that plans are being made to take more of the coal conservation property in order to, I assume, dig well fields or do something over there. So, we see in the plan the statement, and I'm quoting, overcoming a major obstacle to the development of the properties of North Carver Water District. And, you know, I don't think that major obstacle has been overcome yet. I think you're totally optimistic about that. And you're not considering the cost of doing this. Now, in the proposals, several times it had been mentioned in the past that we had a lot of water, and this is going to be helpful to develop this property. But the truth of the matter is, if you cannot put water in the hydrants on Montello Street because there's inadequate water pressure, it seems to me that you're being very bold in determining that you're going to be able to provide water to an enormous industrial park. And it seems to me that fire protection should be the number one issue. And then if you can provide fire protection in the existing hydrants, then maybe you can provide water elsewhere. But the North Carver Water District obviously is going to spend a lot more money in order to be able to provide this water here. And this is not reflected anywhere in the plan where I see it. There is some miscellaneous costs for water mains and so forth, but the real cost of the thing is yet to be considered. I feel that's a major flaw in this plan. Page 50 of the plan says it's going to expand housing opportunities in the town of Carver. And particularly, it mentions affordable housing. I think whoever has that responsibility should be put on alert right now. You're going to need a lot more affordable housing for those 1,500 employees that we plan to get into the park. It also talks about design elements. I think the design elements appeared relatively recently in this process. And I think one of the things that's not discussed there, and I would like to see, is some kind of provision for a barrier between warehouse activity and the residential areas that are right across the line there in Plimpton. And I think that some kind of a wall would need to be constructed, or some kind of a green area of 50 or 100, 150 feet forested to keep down or tamp down the noise that's going to come from these warehouses. It's been suggested several times that the warehouses be situated in such a way that their parking lots are facing Route 44 rather than the residential area. But in the maps I looked at today, I saw nothing about that. On page 60 of the plan, it talks about sources of funding, and it says that Route 44 LLC, does, if they do not fund the project, the town is to seek funding from local, state, and federal sources, but with no indication about what those sources might be. And since we're totally now relying on Route 44 LLC, I have to ask, has anyone thought to receive any documentation on their ability to fund this more than $30 million in activities? Hello? Is anybody paying attention
I'm
here?
I'm trying to follow you. Excuse me. I'm trying to follow your comments.
Okay.
I'm having a tough time following your comments. I am paying attention.
Well, page 60 is what I'm talking about right now.
My page 60 recommends Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act.
Well, this is the one I got online. I'm referring from that. You know, I don't know whether that's different, but the question is very straightforward. Anyone thought to receive documentation on the ability of LLC Route 40 to pay for this more than $32 million in activities?
May I answer the question?
Yep.
Yes. That was done as part of the redevelopers agreement analysis back in April.
That should be in here.
We've asked the question.
Yep. I'm just looking back in all the pages here.
And finally, you know, moving on to the appendices, of which I had not seen before. First of all, the statement by the marketing people that what they're putting forth is statistically unreliable. That's their quote, statistically unreliable, unquote. I find this to be a little disturbing, especially when they clearly pointed out that the real market here for this property was in medical offices. But yet I have not heard of any activity that was ever undertaken by the board or anyone else to see if this was a legitimate thing. Seems to me the developer comes along, wants to take it, sends a secret letter to the selectmen, who look at it under cover of executive session, and suddenly now that's how the whole thing goes. So did we really, after we looked at the marketing plan, try to follow up on those things? I haven't heard or seen any evidence to that. I see that Appendix 3, never mind, you did put that in there. Also, the typographical error of Monticello Street still exists. In the Appendix 5, the term eminent domain is still used. And I believe that word, those words should be taken out of there altogether. Prevent someone else at some later time, in need of some other piece of property relating to this, will go and try to exercise eminent domain. I think it's been quite clear how the citizens are against this idea, and I believe it should be stricken from that appendix. And I think that's the end of that comment.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
I do want to clarify a couple of things for the board. The North Carver Water District does have a DIF that's currently in place. It's been in place for a couple of years. And a DIF is an instrument. It stands for District Improvement Financing. This area is included in the DIF, as is most of North Carver. And the DIF agreement is that 50% of the increase in the revenue, tax revenue from new growth is is funded or sent to fund the North Carver Water District. So that's a longstanding policy that's been in operation for a long time, and it won't change for this project. And the other item I want to talk to you about for the fire suppression. So table 8 in your plan on page 58 does include $2.5 million for a water tower, which would provide the storage that you would need to have operational hydrants in the North Carver Water District. So this would be a water tower that would be constructed as part of this development. It would be tied into the public water system. It's sized at 500,000 gallons, which is the district engineer's recommendation, and it would serve the needs for this development, and it would serve the storage needs to allow the hydrants to be usable system-wide. And for Appendix 5, that's the preliminary development agreement. So this is an agreement that has been in existence with you and the developer since April. And the term eminent domain is used in the act. It's part of the statute. So I don't recommend that you strike that because it's straight from the statute.
Any other questions from the public? Concerns? Please. And then Mrs. Tush.
Hi, I'm John Bonacera from South Carver. While I'm happy that you took the Tushers property off this plan, I know that this is another 11 further properties that are slated to be taken for eminent domain, whether through full taking a partial taking. I'd just like to say that I feel that the taking of any of this private property given to a private developer is unconscionable if used through eminent domain. I feel it's contrary to the values of private property that we hold so dearly in our free market country that we have today. I think it's detrimental to the feelings of security held by our residents here, and it definitely undermines the confidence in the town of Carver's government that we have. I would ask you to let the developers acquire the property through the free market, which was the design of our system in this country, to cease any further misuse of eminent domain. Thank you.
Thank you for your statement.
Karen Tusher, 16 Montello Street, North Carver. I want to thank each one of you on the board for your vote this evening. It means more than you'll ever know. God bless you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I have a question.
Thank you.
My name's Darlene Cassiani. I actually live in Plymouth. My question to you as the board, speaking of the eminent domain properties, is if I'm understanding this correctly, the town of Carver is taking these properties, but is the town prepared financially to, I'm assuming that anyone whose property is taken is going to obtain an attorney and take it to court, because that's, as I've been looking into it, what everybody does. Is the town prepared to absorb that cost of what these properties may be granted afterwards? Or is the developer going to absorb those? Go ahead.
It is covered in the redevelopers agreement.
So, I mean, I'm sure all of you are aware of what has happened in the town of Attleboro. I mean, now that town is $3.5 million in debt because of this same situation. And does the town of Carver, are you prepared for that? Is the developer promising to cover that?
As Marlene stated, it is part of the agreement.
Okay. I just wonder if most of your residents are aware of that. I'm sure this town of Attleboro was not.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. Thank you, everybody, for all your comments and all your input throughout this process. We look forward to more input as this moves forward. I think there's been quite a bit of discussion and input from the public that has been instrumental in the document that's in front of us. What's the pleasure of the board?
Are we supposed to, we're at C now?
Yes. We have a document that's in place. We can bring it forward to the planning board and to the selectmen if you wish. It will require, yes.
I just want to make sure that if you move to vote the plan, it would be conditioned on updating all of the information, the maps, the tables, all of the data with the removal of the Tusher property. So any motion tonight, please make contingent on removal of the Tusher property and changing it from a partial acquisition to no acquisition.
Yep, and that vote's been clear. We already did that vote. So.
I thought we did that vote.
We did. But if you make a motion to bring this document forward, to approve this document,
okay,
in your motion, include that language to remove the Tusher's property from to be acquired, or possibly to be acquired, to not to be acquired.
And also contingent on other changes that we've talked about.
Yeah, so a lot of these pieces will continue to happen. You know, we'll work on the MEPA. Right. We have to continue to just update as we go along. And those, you know, those will, by the time the final vote happens, those will be in the final version. Okay, this is still a draft version. Okay.
So I move that we accept the draft, number one. Number two, totally removing the Tusher's property from that table or any mention thereof, and continue contingent updates of the other things that we've mentioned.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
There's a motion made in second to accept the draft and to remove the Tushers from any of the maps or any other inquiries, from the partial to be acquired to not to be acquired. Any other discussion from the board members, Charlie?
No, I don't have anything.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Those abstention? Unanimous vote. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda be a receipt of an offer of 94 Forest Street, discussion and possible vote. At this time, I am going to step aside from this as a potential person that has made an offer. Happens to be my landlord.
Okay. So we're looking at 75 Silver Street, Carver, Massachusetts. Looks like the offer is for...
It's 94. It's 94 Forest Street. That's the potential purchaser's address.
Oh, sorry about that. Sorry about that. Yeah, to purchase the real property described as 94 Forest Street. It looks like the purchase price the buyer agrees to pay... the sum of $170,000 to the seller for the purchase of the premises. What is the pleasure of the board? Do we accept that? Do we want to accept that that offer?
Can I provide a little background?
Sure.
Yeah.
So 94 Forest Street is the lot that you own. Across the street from the glass
company. The Quickie, that area?
Yeah.
The Quickie Mart, yeah.
Yeah, and the plan is actually in that set of information there. And you had Morse Engineering kind of do some preliminary work for you.
I think we cleaned up the site, if I remember correctly, a little bit, so that way it would be better.
This is... there's a couple of copies. So just... spread these out. This is the location. You own it. while ago you made a motion to put it on the market.
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
And
you know what we put it on the market for?
You listed it at $250.
$250.
You listed it at $250,000 and there was no activity. I forget when, but at some point you lowered the price to $200,000, and this is the first offer you received for at $170,000.
$170,000?
Mm-hmm.
And this is what they're planning on building on it.
No, actually, this is just the conceptual plan that you put together showing what could be built on it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because we thought if it was shelf-ready, right?
Yep. Yeah. So this may not be at all what they have in mind, but it's an example of the type of office building, parking, the well and septic work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of hard to shift gears.
Yeah, sorry about that.
If the person buys this, is there any restrictions? He might do something we don't want.
No, you didn't put any restrictions on it. So it's pretty much whatever's allowed in the zoning district. So we talked about that. It's general business. We talked about that, and I believe the feeling of the board at the time was, you know, you felt that you would get the best price for it without, you know, loading it up with restrictions. So it is there are no covenants in place, just what's allowed under zoning.
But they'd have to follow zoning from the town.
Yep.
And whatever restrictions the town would lay on that particular person or entity that plans on building whatever.
So they would have to meet the zoning requirements as far as their parking and their setbacks. They'd have to meet all the requirements for septic and well setbacks.
Yeah.
But otherwise, it's open for whatever they want to do with it.
Okay.
Well, I guess get rid of it anyway. Put money in the treasury.
Yeah, I think.
Did you see problems with that? Well, what did we spend? A couple grand on this? For the shovel-ready thing?
Oh, for the engineering, yeah, it was minimal.
Yeah.
It was just a matter of, like I said, cleaning it up to make it look
more
presentable, so that way when someone came over there and looked at it, they didn't see
an
empty lot with whatever on it.
Yeah,
so,
falling trees.
Yeah. So, I guess, what's the pleasure of the board?
I guess we can move to accept the offer. Charlie, I don't know.
I'll check.
You want to accept it?
Well, then you have to make a motion. Somebody.
Charlie, want to make that motion?
I make a motion that we accept the
offer.
For
the $170,000.
Yeah, $170,000.
Yes, $170,000.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the motion's been made for. To accept the offer of $170,000.
Mm-hmm.
All in favor, say
aye.
Aye.
Actually, could somebody second?
Oh, I thought.
Second it.
I thought she did.
Thank you.
Well, you didn't ask me to.
Sorry. First time. So.
Chairman now.
Yeah. All right, so where were we? All right, so you seconded it. So all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right, we have a unanimous vote.
Okay, that's it.
Okay, very good.
Can you make a note that Will St. Clair was recused?
Yes.
Yep. You want to keep that?
No, it's not. I don't want
to. Okay, I'm back. Thank you, everybody.
How much pepper?
We fumbled through that one pretty well, I suppose.
That's okay. You do well, I'm sure. Bills payable.
Bills payable.
There you go. Bills payable, Joanna. Treasurer's report. Why don't we start with that?
Quick, all right. The treasurer's report for November. You will see that we moved from savings to checking $1,525. The intention was to pay the secretary, have enough for Serpent's bill, and a little bit extra. That brought that checking account down to $1,603.07. On the savings side, we transferred $1,525 to the checking. Interest was $2.39, so the savings account today has $27,845.43. On the urban renewal side, the account is $28,886.27. With 71 cent interest, it brought it to $28,886.98. With these new bills, Susan Hannon will come out of the checking account side, and Hayes Development Services will come out of the Carver, the urban renewal plan. So that'll just about have that. Marlene, are we going to be okay to keep going? Okay.
Yeah, it'll be okay. We're almost done.
So, what's the pleasure of the board here? I have enough for the Susan. I need have.
So we have to move some money.
Just move. No, I can get it. Yeah, I'll just move for the Hayes Development. So whatever you say.
How much do you need to move?
Well, $12,975 for the Hayes Development has to be moved into the checking.
Yep. Okay.
And I have $1,603.07, so I have enough to pay Susan Hannon, and I don't need to move anymore.
Right. Okay, so the motion would then be to move $12,975 into the checking account.
Correct.
Okay.
From the urban renewal.
From the urban renewal.
Thank you.
Yeah. So that'll make that motion.
I thought I just did.
So I have a second.
Jeff, a second.
A motion and a second to move the sum of $12,975 from the urban renewal account to the checking account to pay Hayes Development Services bill in the sum of $12,975. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Okay. Thing on the treasurer's report. I entertain a motion to accept the treasurer's report. Do I have a second?
I second that motion.
Motion made and second to accept the treasurer's report as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Bills payable. We have a bill for Susan Hannon for the secretarial duties and Hayes Development Services for $12,975. What's the pleasure of the board?
Well, we just moved the money.
We have to make a motion to pay the bills. Yep.
Okay. I like that. Don't pay the bill, move the money.
Make a motion to pay the bill.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
We'll second the paying of the bills. Yes.
Motion made and seconded to pay the bills. One to Susan Hannon for $75. Second will be to Hayes Development Services for $12,975. Any other discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Thank you. Next on the agenda is a letter from Rockland Trust letter dated 11/3/16. What is that?
Yeah, it looks like that. Should be in there somewhere.
That's there. Yeah, after the urban stuff. Mr. Chairman, I called the bank myself to find out what the delay was, and she told me it had already been sent out. I also told her that we would like to present our yearly report April. We don't want it to be so late like this. It's really not our intention. And she said she was some administrative assistant. I don't quite remember her name. She said that wasn't going to be an issue.
Okay.
So we could do that.
Good.
So I'm going to read this into the record, if everybody's okay.
Yep.
It's a letter coming from Rockland Trust, dated November 3rd, 2016, to the Redevelopment Authority. subject matter would be renewal of your line of credit. It has our number on it, origination date, April 23rd, 2009, and the maximum amount of $30,000. It says, dear gentlemen, but I'll amend that to ladies also. We are pleased to inform you that the Rockland Trust Company, the bank, has agreed to renew the above-referenced line of credit dated December 30th, 2017. Prior to the extended credit expiration date, but subject to the documents governing your line of credit, you may continue to utilize the line of credit from your borrowers. All other terms and conditions of the line of credit documents include interest and any other terms of payment in any securities and guarantees shall remain in full force and effect. All references in the said line of credit documents to the credit expiration date shall be deemed to refer to the extended credit expiration date. Unless the line of credit is further renewed by communication in writing from the bank to you prior to the extended credit expiration date, your ability to borrow under the lines of credit will expire on the extended credit expiration date. This letter supersedes all prior oral and written agreements or discussions between the borrower and the bank concerning the line of credit. No officer of the bank or other persons is authorized to make any oral extensions or any other commitments in respect to the line of credit. This letter represents the maximum scope of the extension of the line of credit provided by the borrower of the bank. We appreciate the opportunity to continue working, to continue doing business with you. Sincerely, Rockland Trust. Signature, John S. Davison, First Vice President. So that is great news. Job well done by you and also by Valerie and your help. Thank you very much. Okay. Minutes of November 21st, 2016. What is the pleasure of the board?
Well, I read them. I move that we accept them. I don't know if somebody else wants
to. Do I have a second?
We have a second.
Motion made and seconded to accept the minutes as written or presented. Any other discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next meeting date.
Oh, yeah.
So, Mr. Chairman, I actually recommend that you post your next meeting for Thursday, January 5th, at the Board of Selectmen's hearing for this plan.
Okay.
That way you're covered for open meeting law purposes, that if you want to, if you want to address the board as a committee, you can. I think it would be very helpful to have us all in attendance.
So what did you say, January 5th?
Yep, it's a Thursday, 7
o'clock. It's a 7 o'clock meeting?
Yep.
Where will that be held, here?
Right here.
Right in this room here?
Yep.
Okay.
Anybody care to make that motion? What day is it?
It's Thursday, January 5th, 2017.
It's a Thursday.
Is everybody good with that Thursday?
Yep.
Yep.
Make a motion that our next meeting be held Thursday, 1/5/17 at 7 p.m.
Do I have a second?
Sorry.
Let me get the second first.
Oh, okay.
The second.
Second.
Discussion.
Aye.
Both discussion. And
one thing. So one thing you might want to do is actually post it for 6 or 6:30. So, especially because you have this sale in the works too, that way you can give yourself some time to do business, and then we can, if you can meet at like 6:30, I can post you downstairs in room 3, and then at 7 o'clock I can post you up here at 7.
So 6:30, room 3?
I think just in case you want to do some business, we have the opportunity to.
Probably should, because I'm sure there'll be something that we'll have to clear up. That's a good idea. 6:30. So you want me to
Where's room 3?
Downstairs, the basement.
Oh, the basement?
Well, okay. that's room four, but that's
room,
okay.
Yeah, room, I mean, it's a small office.
Where's the big, where?
I always thought that was room three.
I'll post it for room four. You guys all know
there
where that is.
We'll find out when. So you want to revise your...
Yeah, we'll revise. So room four? Okay, here it comes. So I'll make a motion that our next meeting be held on 1/5/17, Thursday evening at 6:30 p.m. in room four.
No, okay, 1/5, yeah.
1/5?
Yeah, 1/5.
January 5th.
That's January 5th, 2017. For all of us.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Wherever room three is, I don't know.
All in favor say aye.
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 Okay.
We'll be there.
We're good with all that, right? The only thing else I have is to wish everybody safe and happy holidays. You guys all set? Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to check to see, I had sent you an email with the procedure we're discussing closing Montello.
Could you just come up here?
Yeah. My name is Christine Joy from the Board of Selectmen. I emailed you guys, it's probably about a month and a half ago, the procedure from Copeland and Page about what would be required if you wanted to close Montello to through traffic. So I just wanted to make sure you got it, and if you didn't, I'll resend it.
You have it. It's in your appendix number 6 on your plan from Alana Court.
Yep.
At KMP.
Perfect.
Yep.
Excellent. Great. Okay.
Thank you.
You
so much. Thank you for attending.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anything else from anyway? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Have a merry Christmas.
Is that a motion?
I'll make a motion to...
A happy new year.
To adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and second to adjourn. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Thank you, everybody.
Been stepped
happy holidays.